take it away.
Okay, hello. My name is Chelsea D'Souza. Thank you for joining me today. So this program is called The Silk Road. It's basically about cultural exchange through music, and specifically between East and West. So the reason I got interested in this is because I grew up in India, in Mumbai. My family's from a place called Goa, which was under the Portuguese. And because of that, you know, I grew up playing Western classical music. And my last name, D'Souza, is Portuguese. And people have always been kind of confused by that, you know, the fact that I don't play Indian music. And so I've always been really fascinated by what happens when cultures interact, what happens to their music, and how does these cultural interactions actually change and influence what composers are writing. So of course the Silk Road was this network of trade routes that connected East and West. But I started to think about what was happening more than just the trade and the economic interaction, what was happening with their cultural interaction. So the first two pieces on this program are by a French composer, Claude Debussy. Debussy was really fascinated with capturing the sounds of nature and portraying that in his music. And in 1889, he went to the Universal Exposition in Paris, which was this world fair where people from all over the world came to show off the best of their culture. And he encountered this troupe of dancers and musicians from the Dutch colony of Java, which we know as Indonesia today. And he was fascinated by their traditional music, which was this ensemble called the gamelan, sort of these metallic sounding instruments, or like gongs and bells. And so in the first piece you hear today, Pagodes, you can see how he's captured the sounds of the gamelan ensemble. And in the second piece, which is not directly related to the gamelan, it's called Reflections of the Water, you see how he uses those bell-like sounds, but this time to evoke falling droplets of water. So I hope you enjoy these first two pieces, Pagodes and then Reflections in the Water. Thank you. can see, Debussy was very inspired by the timelessness of Javanese music when he was trying to capture nature in those two pieces you just heard. But, you know, Debussy wasn't certainly the first composer, Western composer, to try to capture the sounds of nature in music. So I thought I would share some music that's not exactly inspired by the East, but certainly has to do with nature, by a very famous composer, Frédéric Chopin. So these two preludes are from his set of 24 preludes, and I think what's beautiful about hearing them next to the Debussy is you can see the big difference in how that nature inspiration manifests in the music. So in the first prelude, you hear this, I like to think of this image of a boat ride, like a Venetian gondola or something. And you're, you know, traveling down one of the canals, and it's a conversation happening between two lovers. And, you know, there's a little bit of tension in the middle, there's a little bit of a quarrel, and then they slowly drift off into the sunset. And then the second prelude is probably his most famous, called the Raindrop Prelude, where we have the same piece, the same note repeating throughout the piece to evoke falling raindrops. So these are two Chopin preludes for you.
Thank you.
after the raindrop, because I feel like it's this like storm immediately after this very calm drizzle that we have. So moving away from the Western Hemisphere, we can follow that line of Debussy being inspired by the Javanese gamelans to a composer from Japan named Toru Takemitsu. Takemitsu, his whole ethos, he loved Debussy and that idea of coloring music with light and shadow. And so he tried to fuse what he learned from Debussy's aesthetic with his own Japanese traditional music. So the idea he's exploring in this next piece called the Rain Tree Sketch is the concept of ma, which most directly translates to time-space. So sort of feeling the silences between the notes and not just being anxious for sound all the time. So for him, the silence means just as much as the music. So the name of this piece, The Rain Tree Sketch, refers to this novel called The Clever Rain Tree by a very famous poet, Kensaburo Oe. And the image is of this giant rain tree gathering water in its foliage and keeping the ground moist around it. So I hope you enjoy Toru Takemitsu's Rain Tree Sketch. with South Asian heritage, with other styles of music like Western classical music. And so the next two composers you will hear are both of Indian origin. So the first one, Sohrabji, was a British Indian composer whose father was a Parsi, a Zoroastrian businessman from India, and his mother was English. And so he grew up in England, and really, you know, he studied Western classical piano, but because he was someone growing up in England, someone of mixed ancestry, he felt very alienated from British society, and actually was quite harassed during his childhood, and that made him really move away from the British aspects of his identity, and really embrace his Indian Zoroastrian identity. So he changed his name. He was originally born Leon Dudley, and then he changed it with a traditional Parsi ceremony to Kai Khosru Shakurji Sohrabji. And from then on, he really embraced the Indo-Persian literature and culture, and cited that as inspiration for his music. Now, when you hear the piece that I'm about to play for you in the hothouse, you might think that there's not actually any Indian influence in it, and certainly it sounds very Debussy-esque. The truth is, Sohrabji had a relatively orientalist perspective of India. He had never visited, and most of what he read about the country was from texts that were written by very orientalist writers. And so when he describes this piece, he, in the hothouse, he describes it as this tropical greenhouse experience, and he says, the languid, voluptuous ecstasy of tropical heat and the narcotic perfume that pervades the music. Now, the heat in Mumbai, at least in India, is just as bad as it is here in Houston. So I don't think any of us would call it languid, voluptuous ecstasy. So I think you can clearly see how Sohrabji has a relatively orientalist fantasy of South Asia. But it's a very beautiful piece. And then in great contrast, the composer that I will play for you after Sohrabji, her name is Rina Esmail, and she was born in 1983 in California and has studied both Hindustani classical music as well as Western classical music. So in the two pieces that I'll play of hers, she actually fuses the Indian rags of Hindustani music with her Western classical training. So it's a much more direct and in-depth, complex interaction between the two musical cultures. So the first piece I'll play of hers is called Rangde Basant, which means give it the color of spring. And you know, much in line with Debussy's attempts to color his music with the sounds of nature, Rina here is playing with the idea of Basant, of spring, which is a much darker color than the pastel colors we evoke, you know, with the Western conception of spring. So that's Rangde Basant. And then the piece that follows, I think, is a really beautiful expression of her dual identity as an Indian American. It's called America / Desh. Now, Desh means country in Hindi. And here she fuses the song America the Beautiful with a rag called Desh, so the rag of country. So it's a really beautiful amalgamation of these two very, very important identities. So I hope you enjoy the set of three pieces by Indian composers. Thank you. for you a little lighter segment now. You know, I've listened to a lot of jazz, and I think the fusion of jazz and classical is also a great way in which we can see how cultures interact. So this first piece needs no introduction. It's Gershwin's famous Summertime, as you know, is a great comes from a great opera about black culture written by Gershwin. And then this arrangement is by a Turkish concert pianist named Fazıl Say. And then the last piece is actually a jazz prelude and fugue. Now, I don't know if you've heard of a prelude and fugue, but it was very commonly written by the classical composer Johann Sebastian Bach in like the 16 and 1700s, so a long, long time ago. But this is a jazz prelude and fugue by an Austrian pianist named Friedrich Gulda. Now, Gulda actually was growing up during World War II at a time when jazz was banned, and so he would sort of play it on the down low with his friends. And so he developed as both a very accomplished classical as well as jazz pianist. And so here in this piece, he fuses his two great loves of Bach and jazz. So I hope you enjoy this last segment.